of all the BIMSTEC countries. The Fourth BIMSTEC Summit Declaration resolved to develop a plan of action for collective response to climate change in the region. Preservation of mountains and oceans is therefore an urgent priority. May I now request Mr. Ganesh Shah, former Minister for Environment, Science and Technology, Chair Session 3, and our distinguished panelists, Mr. Langa Dorji, National Environment Commission, NEC, Royal Government of Bhutan, Dr. Bivash Pandav, Scientist, Department of Endangered Species Management, Wildlife Institute of India, Mrs. Wanapa Leerasiri, Lecturer, Chiang Mai University, Mrs. Vasekha Ayesha Khan, MP, Chattogram, Mr. Lakshman Bahadur Basnet, Asian Institute of Diplomacy and International Affairs, and Ms. Ruvanti Jayasekara, Research Assistant, Institute of National Security Studies, Sri Lanka, to please take their seats on the dais. I request all speakers to finish their presentations in the allotted 10 minutes so that the floor can be opened to the audience too. As mentioned in the previous sessions, we will keep the protocol of the chair ringing the bell once at 9 minutes and twice at 10 minutes. I now hand over the proceedings to the chair.
Thank you. Is it listening? It's okay. Okay, so I was just thinking this is the last session today. Today is last session. So normally when the students are sitting in the room, they say when that class will be over. So they want the teachers that you should do. See? And normally they are also very, those who sit till the last moment, they are the best listeners and best students, we call in the student time. So I welcome all of our panelists in the session and all the dignitaries sitting in the hall. You see, as I told just immediately, this is the today's last session. And after the lunch, even there is a session. I did not listen any snoring. Otherwise, in some conferences, when you go, somebody is snoring also, you see. That shows that everybody is taking the things very seriously, you see. So this is the session we are talking on the two issues. One is the environment and another is the climate change. And I'm very happy that seeing in this session that this is a very, what I call, gender friendly or inclusive. I don't see in any session there has been out of the seven, three.
In the first session, there were two ladies.
Two ladies. But in this session, there are three ladies. Yes. So I am very privileged, you see, to sit with this. And I remember my one of the meetings I was when I was the minister in the Nairobi, the UNEP, I was sitting all the ladies ministers of the environment, you see. Because environment is a big concern for the women perspective or the gender perspective, you call it. So welcome to especially, and there's young ladies also, member of the parliament. So I was thinking that when all these sessions are going, this environment and the climate change issues is a concern of everybody issues, you see. When I say in this hall, the Delhi pollution, air pollution, we talk in the environment. Then everybody will talk, oh, you are going to Delhi, Delhi air pollution. They are very alert, you see. But whoever is sitting here, everybody is inhaling the same air. So you will have the same impact on that. So environment is become everybody issues, and it has become the 21st generation, especially the young generation agenda of this environment. Another issue of the climate change, you see, just I think, I don't know, the speaker previous were talking about the IPCC, this 51, special report on the oceanic and cryosphere in the changing climate briefing on LDC and IPCC focal points, you see. So now, just after a week, I think, our all the people will be sitting, going to the Greece, no.
Spain.
On the COP. And you see, so it will be again talking about all these things. So I don't want to take much more time because all these our distinct panel are prepared for these things. I'll just say in the last few words. But What was the, you see, I come from a country where the previous, this fourth BIMSTEC summit was held last year, and which had taken a special decisions on the forming, taking a special committee of the experts on the climate change issue. I don't know whether it has been formed or not, but I think this dialogue will initiate forming that committee. So with these few remarks, I welcome all the our experts. I think as the previous speaker said, those biodata is here. You know them. If those, I think Lakshmanji biodata is not here, or is somebody else, I don't know. So we'll start from the, you see, as everybody started from the right, and you see we two countries, Nepal and Bhutan, in the previous, we're talking about the mountainous country. So I request Langa Dorji, that's also Nepali name, you can talk to him in Nepali also, you see. So I request you to start, and please be on time.
Very good afternoon to all of you. Thank you, Honorable Chair, distinguished panelists, participants, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank BIMSTEC and then the organizer for inviting us. And I'm very privileged to be one of the participants out here. And this is my first time that I'm participating in this BIMSTEC. So in this given topic, I would like to bring to the context that Bhutan has been playing a very important role in preservation and promotion of environment. At the same time, we have been giving our best to the world that we remain carbon neutral for all the time to come. And then, as you all know that one of the pillars of cross-national happiness is environment conservation. And then our constitution mandates that we maintain 60% of forests all the time. So with these our important policy in our hand, we try our level best for the conservation of environment at the same time to tackle the climate change related issues. Under the Paris Agreement, the Bhutan has committed to remain carbon neutral for all the time to come. Ethically, this pledge was made in the view that keeping the planet safe for all the life, and the climate change pledge will technically determine by the level of emission from the economic activities as well as the net sequestration from our forests and biodiversity, basically within from the mountain ecosystem. The Bhutan has a strategic and policy of managing its own emission through the 9 priority mitigation and 8 adaptation as given in our NDC. So Bhutan, well, with this long stage, we have also learned a lot of lessons, and then we are also challenged with the number of due to the location of our country. And I would like to bring to the floor that what are some of the challenges that we have encountered, some of the measures that we have taken, and at the same time, what should be the way forward for the BIMSTEC country to move forward. So to start, basically, let me confess that I'm not a climate specialist. In Bhutan, we have a number of issues, both environmental as well as climate change related issues. First of all, we have water scarcities in our country, and basically at the same time we have in this region. The very interesting thing is that Bhutan, we have a highest capita water in the world, but at the same time, Bhutan, we have a water shortage scarcities in our country. And then drying up of water sources is another serious issue that we have with the with this climate change impact. And then the country at this juncture is that we are facing a lot of data. We are we have a very limited data on the vulnerability of farming communities. The vulnerability assessment that we have in our country is focused on sector specific for the water, agriculture, forest, and the energy. And then the land degradation, soil erosion is also the one of the major concerns for the Bhutan. And then due to the geographical terrain aggravated by the extreme weather, the topsoils takes place on the slope are decreasing. Then the climate change, while we have trying to address through the, some of the projects called NAPA, we have taken a we have completed first. At the same time, we have also completed the second NAPA project. Through this mechanism, we are trying to address our climate change issues. But the lesson learned from them is that at the end of the day, when we are trying to tackle these issues, we require to finance. So financial problem is one of the serious concerns, and then I'm pretty sure that it applies to across this BIMSTEC country, countries. And then the lack of technical expertise at this juncture to this particular, to my country, is that we have very limited people who has very knowledge on this, and we have also a very limited researchers within the countries. And then the lack of appropriate technology is also the one of the thing that we encounter as a lesson learned and the challenges that we confront every day. And then the one of the activity that program that we have taken was the GLOVE, the Glacier Lake Outblast. As just to the latest report shows that we have more than 700 glacier lake on the mountain, out of which the 17 is critical, the latest report published by the National Environment Commission. And then the studies carried out by Ministry of Economic Affairs. So that is the main concern that we have. At the same time, what I feel is that as a BIMSTEC country and the upstream as well as the downstream countries also need to prepare accordingly with these issues. Then we have not only that, as the countries prosper with the development activities, we are also encounter with a lot of waste management issues, not only within the cities, but even to the rural areas and the communities. This is also becoming the one of the major environmental issues in our country. And I'm pretty sure this issue also applies to the BIMSTEC countries. So in the NAPA 2 project, we have taken a flood-induced resilience project within the community, and then the, some of the information and then the disaster-related activities. At the same time, to make this monitoring system and the information sharing within these affected areas. So with that context, I would like to submit my options for the way forward to the BIMSTEC country. First of all, what I feel is that we need to have strengthen the collaboration on research on climate change modeling to understand better on the climate trend and the impacts at the regional as well as sub-level. The research studies should also focus very specifically on these mountains. Mountain specific needs to be specified in these categories. Second thing is that second submission I would option is that the regional focusing of mechanism for transboundary pest and disease control, as well as the hazard management. For example, even in the Bhutan, the recent incident that we had was the malaria dengue outbreak. Even the cold place, capital city, when there was, when we can find rarely a few mosquitoes, now the people there used to get this dengue outbreak. So the country, in this context, we need to have a mechanism within these BIMSTEC countries to tackle this type of issues. And the third thing is that originally, there is also need to have a strong collaboration in the field of research and the capacity building. Data management, information sharing on climate change adaptation and measures. For example, within the BIMSTEC country, we need to have how to transfer the technologies. And it should be very accessible within, and then then the best practices that can be adopted from country to country in a most collaborative manner. Not only that, we need to focus on providing some of the research work, exchange program, internship, and the capacity building on GIS and information. So beside the fourth, the option I would suggest is, beside the multilateral and bilateral funding source, there's also need for urgent to see and the possibility of funding, developing a funding mechanism within the BIMSTEC countries. However, every country within the BIMSTEC should be able to invest within the for the cause of this climate change. Basically, in terms of capacity building, awareness, and research, and so on. With that options, I would like to thank all of you for your patience and listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Langa Dorjiji. Now I will request Dr. Vivash Pandam from WII.
Sir.
You explain, sir, what is WII also, huh? So please.
Well, I am from the Wildlife Institute of India. That is an autonomous body of Ministry of Environment and Forest. And that is entrusted with study, I mean training. Our primary mandate is training and then doing research and education. So I will just narrate you an episode that spanned over a period of 7 years. And this episode forms an integral part of my life. This was between 1993 and 99. I was carrying out my doctoral research on marine turtles. So 7 years I lived in a small, very tiny little island, and the area was less than half a square kilometer, this island. One side of the island was the estuary, huge estuary of Brahmini and Baitarani River, and the other side was Bay of Bengal. And I was studying marine turtles and was witnessing one of nature's unique extravaganza. Nature's unique extravaganza in the sense only two other countries in this world have the privilege of witnessing such kind of things, where marine turtles come and nest in hundreds of thousands over a span of 6-7 nights only in a year. So the two other countries are Mexico and Costa Rica, and other than Mexico and Costa Rica, India has the distinction. Along east coast of India in the state of Orissa, we have the largest turtle nesting beach. So I was studying there. And as I told, one side of the island was estuary, the other side was Bay of Bengal. And me being a genetic mixture of Bengali and Oriya, had a great affinity for fish. So the entire life was dependent on fish. You want to eat anything, breakfast fish, lunch fish, dinner fish, you just go to the estuary, go to the sea, cast a net and catch fish. So that's how life was going on. And when I was thoroughly enjoying my life, eating fish, studying turtles, there was a huge amount of conflict going on in the sea. There was the area where I was working was a marine protected area, Gahirmatha Marine Wildlife Sanctuary. Officially, fishing was banned in that place, but Coast Guard patrols in that area. The State Forest Department also patrols in that area. And fishermen fish in that area. Fishing is illegal because it's a protected area. And whenever fishermen enter there, the enforcement agency go there, catch them, and huge amount of conflict. Conflict in the sense of gunfire and killing of fishermen and then damage of property, all those things were going on. So when I started introspecting into this whole thing, started talking to the fishermen, you know there's so much of danger involved in coming and fishing in this place. Why the hell you are coming again and again to this place and encountering this problem and aggravating this situation? Told, sir, there is no fish elsewhere. Okay, we can't go, sir, 100 kilometer, 20 kilometer, 30 kilometer, 40 kilometer. Fish is there only in this river mouth area, only in this estuarine area, and only in this protected area. And you go elsewhere, it's all overfished. Fisheries resources are highly depleted. Just before this session, we are talking about blue economy. I am talking about the livelihood of local communities or the coastal communities. Climate is changing. The island where I was living, 14 kilometers down south of that island, villagers were working with me. 8 villagers were working with me as assistant. They were taking me in their boat to the sea. I was going and catching turtles every day and tagging them. So, and now that village is abandoned. I did my study between 93 and 99. In 2000, today you go 2019, the village is eaten up by the sea. Sea level is increasing. This village name is Satvaya on the coast of Orissa, has been completely eaten up. Villagers have shifted inland. So it has a direct relevance to the food security of the area, of the coastal people or of the people living in this region. And the moral of the story is we have created marine protected area. First of all, we do not have adequate marine protected area. We have few marine protected area and they are very, very poorly managed. Compared to a protected area in a terrestrial system, marine protected areas are free of chronic problem of people living inside. The biggest problem in a protected area in a terrestrial ecosystem is lot of villages, lot of people dependent on that area. There are absolutely no villages in a marine protected area. Only people go there for fishing. And in fact, wherever marine protected areas they are there, maximum amount of fishing takes place due to poor lack of law enforcement. Because first of all, it's difficult to enforce law like establish chokies or establish patrolling station. Those kind of things are difficult in those areas. So that's why taking advantage of that, lot of fishing takes place. So my intervention or my request in this forum is we need to critically look at the spread of marine protected areas in the region and find out the status of marine protected areas in this place and how effectively we can govern these marine protected areas, thereby providing livelihood opportunities to the coastal fishermen. The entire fisheries resources of the coastal area, I'm not talking about deep sea areas, of the coastal region, say 20 kilometers from the shoreline, is totally dependent on the survival of these marine protected areas. If we do not protect these things, these are the nurseries of our fishery resources. If we do not protect these areas, the fishery resources is going to deplete. It is happening. When I was working, when I was doing my doctoral research, fishermen, the trawl fishers, they were catching a lot of fish. They were sorting out only shrimp and prawn and throwing rest of the catch back to the sea. Those days we were calling them as bycatch. There is nothing called bycatch nowadays. Every single catch that is caught in the net is utilized. If not for human purpose, it is utilized for poultry industry to making poultry feed, or it is being going to a lot of other places. So there is nothing called bycatch, because fish catch is has reduced to such an extent, and the cost of fishing has gone up in terms of the fuel prices have gone up, labor has gone up. So they are not willing to do away with a single catch which is not of much commercial value. So the fishery resources are depleting, and if we do not protect these coastal areas or these marine protected areas and create additional marine protected areas, we are going to face a major problem, especially when people are getting displaced. And as far as my study subject is concerned, marine turtles, they are facing great problem because of this climate change. Because first thing is their nesting ground. They live entire life, they live in the sea, only 1.5 hours they come in a year to lay eggs on the beach. And these beaches are disappearing because of beach are getting eroded quietly. And then the other thing, very unique to marine turtles, or for that matter most reptiles, is their gender is determined by temperature, not by chromosome. They don't have X and Y chromosome like us. So depending on the temperature, with the increase in temperature, increase in sea level, more and more sea water is ingressing into the land, thereby reducing the temperature of the beach. We think that temperature is increasing, it is actually reducing the temperature of the beach through tidal inundation. As a result, they are producing more males. In case of sea turtles, the lower the temperature, more males are produced, higher the temperature, more females are produced. So it's becoming a male biased society. It's something like what we are witnessing in the state of Haryana. The same problem is happening with sea turtles. So So I would plead as a biologist, as a person working in coastal area for quite some time in my life, I would say, sir, we need to look at the spread of marine protected area within our region and safeguard this marine protected area. These are not to alienate people from fishing in those areas, but to promote a sustainable and promote a long-term livelihood opportunity, provide a long-term livelihood opportunity to local people. And before I conclude, I have one request to the director of VIF. Sir, I am not drinking water since morning because, sir, I request if we can find an alternate thing, because some of these bottles will find their way to our seas and oceans. And it has taken a lot of effort on our part to make this change in my own institute. Although we are a wildlife institute, we are using a lot of plastic bottles. But we have started using glass bottles, and it's a very small thing, sir, but it will make a big change to ensure the safeguard of our seas. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Actually, we have to make a lot of behavioral change, you see. But anyhow, thank you very much for the insights. Now I will request Madam Basika Ayusha Khan to make your deliberation, Madam.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. Good afternoon, everyone. I was listening with rapt attention to Dr. Pandav about the turtles. What am I doing here? I am not an expert on the environment. I am not an academic. I am here representing the people of Bangladesh, of the coastal area of Bangladesh, and countries in the BIMSTEC who also have the coasts, and how we are being affected in our day-to-day lives by climate change. Climate emergency, actually. It's no longer climate change. Personal story, the home that four generations of my family have grown up in, including myself, gets, when there's very high tide, it's in the city, it's in Chattogram. When it's very high tide, the water comes in the courtyard. That is it was unthinkable maybe 10, 12 years ago. There are many parts of Chattogram which get inundated due to the sea level rise. And like Dr. Pandav mentioned, the pollution that we are subjecting our seas to is not helping. One river, we are dredging our rivers in Bangladesh, right? During dredging, one of the river basins were found to have meters and meters of plastic. And the machine could not work because the machine is going to dredge and supposed to dredge the ground, right? They're replacing the machines. That is what we are doing to the to our environment. And it was rightly said by the chair that environment issues do have a gender gender factor. Women have to go for kilometers to get drinking water. And women, when family become climate refugees, women bear the brunt. So, what is BIMSTEC doing about this? You know, we have countries like India and Sri Lanka, Bangladesh. We are all affected by natural calamities to certain degrees. And it's definitely due to the climate emergency. We have our own, nation's laws, like, marine protected areas. We have in Bangladesh marine protected areas, the Forest Act, many, many laws, many, many acts. But ultimately, if we are not working together towards a shared goal in the region, if I'm trying to protect my coast, see, the coastal green belt that Bangladesh has nurtured from 1972, it protected Bangladesh from many, many cyclonic storms. We had to do away of hundreds of acres of that coastal green belt in Teknaf to make room for the forcibly displaced Rohingyas from Myanmar. So conflict or any other situation definitely affects the environment. We have seen it in our history. So what is the way forward? Bangladesh, in our last session of parliament, we have passed a motion in November, on November 13th, we passed a motion. Actually, Bangladesh Parliament has become the first parliament to pass this motion on declaring planetary emergency. Maybe our colleagues in BIMSTEC can also take this forward. There are 23 parliaments in the world who have declared climate emergency, but we have gone one step further and declared planetary emergency, which is actually the situation we are in. We can talk about blue economy, we can talk about security, we can talk about so many things. But in this region, poverty is an issue, food security is an issue. If we are destroying the resources, security will not, any other sort of security is not going to help us. It will not go, it will not fill our bellies. It will not, take us forward. When we are talking about sustainable industrialization, in the BIMSTEC region, there are countries who are, more industrialized, maybe emitting more, but there are also countries like Bhutan, which gross national happiness and their emphasis on environment is highly admirable. Bangladesh does have one of the highest number of green factories in the world. We are, taking the right step in the right direction. But of course, we have to work together. We have to share expertise. And in my humble opinion, BIMSTEC gives climate change is it's a crucial area of cooperation for BIMSTEC. But what concrete steps have been taken so far? I don't see too many. And of course, when we are talking about funding for such issues, where is the fund coming from? All the member countries have priorities, like development, etc., etc. Many, many, we all know that. So where is the fund coming from? And we have had experience of donor agencies forcing down, forcing certain steps on us, which in the long run have actually damaged our environment. We must also be aware of that. So we cannot, go take suggestions from very faraway lands who do not know what our region's environment is like. So I would like to make a few suggestions about nationally determined contributions. How are we determining that in the BIMSTEC region? And about finances, we can think of green bonds. We can actually think of green bonds in this region. And of course, funds, resources are to be used optimally. There has to be steps which make accountable and ensure that funds are being used properly. And we can have special biodiversity conservation areas. I'm sure we all have in most of the member nations. And there are ecologically critical areas. There we can talk about river basin management. It was a very interesting session in session two when we were talking about the MDA. And river basin management is another huge issue related with the environment. Because Bangladesh, for my country, it's big because we are a riverine country. So many people's livelihoods depend on the river. And when we are talking about cooperation and river transport, it also affects the whole region. You know, I feel that, you know, slow, quiet, incremental policies, like, you know, planting seagrass meadows, it may be our best hope, not only big dramatic projects, which require a lot of money. We should start and work together yesterday, because there is no planet B. And none of us want to have climate refugees. Thank you so much for the opportunity to talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Honorable Member of the Parliament. As you told, there is no other planet, you see. So everybody has to protect it. So now the next speaker is from Nepal, from where I am also. As you know, as a water tower of the Asia, you see. So the climate change, you see, is a big impact on the water. Our doctor has not drink water. This year I was reading in the media in India there was a big drinking water problems in the different mega cities, you see. And in the coming days also there will be big issues, I think. So we have to work on this and see. So now I request Lakshman Basnetji from Nepal, who is a former bureaucrat, and he's experts on the multimodal transport also. When the previous session was going, I was just looking at him, that how he's thinking. But this time we'll talk about the issues of climate and environment. Basnetji.
Good afternoon to all distinguished delegates. Thank you very much for the organizer, especially Dr. Gupta and his entire team. It gives me great pleasure to be here representing the country of Nepal, emerging climate change issue, especially in the BIMSTEC region. Yes. Our topic is environment and climate change and preserving the mountain and ocean ecosystem. There is two different parts. One is the preserving mountain and second one is the ecosystem of the ocean. So I also want to make it clear about the two differently, you know. We are familiar with fact this organization is the larger one in terms of the population and land area, which consists of the mountainous country, highest in the world, to the coastal. Yes, climate change is a pertinent issue. So we put it in the BIMSTEC key area of cooperation. I think this is recently, that means the 14th of the out of the 14 is climate change issue is incorporated in the this cooperation area. So actually climate change is not the challenge only for the BIMSTEC region. It is the global phenomena. So now, I'm going to share my experience. What should we do in the mountain area and what should we do in the ocean area? And what is the major issues in the mountain region and what is the emerging issues in the ocean region? So we all are feeling individually that the mountain and the coastal region have different issues. Temperature rising due to the carbon emission and plain areas, in plain areas, increases the atmosphere temperature in the mountains and melt down in the ice, resulting flood, landslide, and erosion. Similarly, emerging issues on the ocean region are, we all know that some of the emerging issues in ocean zone are accumulations of the debris, plastic, and depletion of fisheries and rapid population growth. It has raised the water level in the coastal zone that has created great challenge for survival. These are the basic character and issues of the mountain and the ocean region. So what is the environmental consequences after this issue? So we have to think and we have to take the serious efforts from the BIMSTEC family. So I have mentioned some of the consequences. It is true, we face resource depletion, food and water supplies problem, and degradations of the public health due to the environment pollution were especially affected in the poor people. Now, I'm going to tell something about the how to preserve the mountains and how to preserve the ocean region. Every problem have possible solution. The only thing is that we should be serious and take action immediately so that we can save the glacier by managing carbon emission, modern way of farming, and reduce plastic consumption. Similarly, how to preserve the ocean? In reality, ocean itself is not a sole problem. In addition to mountain, to pressure the ocean, fishing, extraction industries, coastal shipping should be utilized in manageable and environmental sustainable scale. Yes, we know we have a couple of laws that we have already incorporated in the BIMSTEC regime. There are some of the hard laws and some of the soft laws also. So we have plenty of related laws and regulations, but that needful to enforcement. In changing context, the new laws and regulations also required. Now I want to share my some views. What is the shared destiny? What is the collective destiny for the BIMSTEC region, for the BIMSTEC countries? We have already presented major environmental and climate change issue and its consequences as well as their mitigation measures. It cannot be addressed in isolation. Yes, ocean and mountains are interrelated. So I want to put here some few interrelated between our BIMSTEC countries. It cannot be addressed in isolation. When we all have not contributed environmental degradation equally, the larger GDP country and greater polluters should contribute accordingly. What is the interlink between our BIMSTEC region, our countries? I want to clear some of the three, 4 points, how we are interlinked. Evaporated air formed in Bay of Bengal precipitated in the mountain and produces ice in the irrigates through the plain in the Gangas. Snow melting in the mountain is primarily caused by the huge industrial setup and consumption practices in one place and affected whole region. The glacier lake outburst floods may originate in one location and have massive downstream impact that appears itself in the flood landscape and erosion. Temperature rise caused by the carbon emission melts down the ice in which ultimately rise ocean level. And one more thing, timely and intensive consensus is required to avoid cascading effects that may unfold vulnerable disaster. Problems to be addressed collectively. So this is my important suggestion to this floor. We are not equally doing all these things. I have already said we have a larger country and we have a smaller country also. So our environment and climate change effects is not equally. So I recommend this forum, problems to be addressed collectively, proportionately, and ability to pay concept in terms of financial contribution, number one, number two, technological inputs, and number three, spreading the awareness. Similarly, promoting low carbon economy. We all know formulating and enforcing the hard and soft law. One minute more, please. Implementation of the, this is my second important recommendation to this floor. Implementation of the Kathmandu Declaration in Fourth Summit in 2018. Yes, our Prime Minister KP Ohli addressed in his inauguration speech, we are ready to make some compatible law to reduce and to mitigate the climate change and environmental change. So now we have already completed our formulation of the law. Climate Change Act, Climate Change Policy, and now our environmental and forest ministry also making the some guideline regarding that issue. Now, lastly, we are going to make one important Everest dialogue in the March, April 2020. So I want to invite all of BIMSTEC participation to participate in this climate change event. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lachan Basneji. It is known as the Sagarmatha Sambat. It is the Everest dialogue, or you see, it is going hosted by the government of Nepal. We are inviting dignitaries from the different countries. Our foreign minister is now in the Moscow, so has gone to invite the Putin and from there also. And they have already sent letter to the different countries, and we'll be happy to welcome the experts and dignitaries from the BIMSTEC also. Now, I think I request Ruwanti Jayasekhara. She is the research assistant from the Institute of National Security Studies of Sri Lanka, which is under the Ministry of Defense. And when I see at you, I feel that we are from the mountain and all water goes down. You see? So you have the floor. I think you will speak more on the research aspect, I hope. Please.
afternoon, everyone. I'm Ruwanti Jayasekhar from the Institute of National Security Studies. Honorable panelists, and thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Vivekananda, the International Foundation, for hosting and inviting me. So moving on to my topic, the way forward through preserving mountains and ocean ecosystems. So we are no more in the age that we consider preserving mountains and ocean ecosystems just an environmental issue. And also, this is not just limited to a local national security issue. This is transboundary. Decades back, who thought that smog would be a national or an international security issue? And this shows the gravity of environmental issues. If ignored, this could lead towards economical, social, and political consequences, ultimately leading even towards the collapse of the national security system and the international system as well. I'll be not going to focus on the significance of the mountains and ocean ecosystems, and it is displayed right here. So I'll be focusing on the recommendations as to how to ensure that we preserve mountain and ocean ecosystems. So number one is strengthening existing policies. So it is interesting that the Fourth BIMSTEC Summit Declaration focuses on cooperation for climate change and also conservation to support sustainable development. One of the two key areas that they have focused was the mountain economy and blue economy. Not only BIMSTEC, but also some other organizations like now the emerging concept of Indo-Pacific, all of them have looked at environment as a source of blue economy. Certain statistics from Sri Lanka, 25% of the population live in coastal areas, and 62% of the industrial units are in these coastal areas, and also 70% tourist infrastructure is available in coastal areas. So you see the gravity of it. Environment is a major source of economy. And the BIMSTEC Center for Weather and Climate, this also play a major role in early warnings and climate risk assessment. So taking once again another example from Sri Lanka, now Sri Lanka faces massive floods, and now this has become like an annual event, natural disaster. And as a developing country, we are forced to pay more for the recovery of the natural disasters. And this in detail, of course, a threat to the economy and also the national security of the country. So you see, all these policies or the recommendations, like the existing policies, are not just focusing on the environmental aspect of it, but also the economic, the social, and the political aspect of it. My second recommendation is dissemination of knowledge and capacity building. Number one is, I feel that there should be a comprehensive database of most threatened and endangered and extinct species, and also to ensure that there are data available on existing threats and the impact of it. So what is best is this could be achieved through different workshops and training sessions on existing threats and policy recommendation. And this organization, BIMSTEC itself, could be a best platform for this, and think tanks could bring these to the table of implementation. And also, rather than join initiatives with developed countries and extra-regional countries, we could just share knowledge and learn from each other from the region itself. And if properly done, dissemination of knowledge among the BIMSTEC countries could be a really good advantage. Because considering the background situations, considering similar background situations, the solutions can be the same. And the next is education and awareness. So, quoting UNESCO, education can bring about a fundamental shift in how we think and act. So first of all, education since school level, and this is not just limited to what's environment and what's climate change, but more focus on renewable energy, smart and resource efficient cities, and what's more utilized in the digital world, you know, in order to act in a more practical and a digitalized system. And next should be the research and development, like it was mentioned by some of the other panelists. And specifically, Agenda 21 and chapter 13 of the Agenda 21 focuses, like, pays more attention to research and development. And this is where foresight analysis comes in handy. As a foresight officer, what we do is you analyze the current trends of environment and the climate change and try to draw what the future will look like. And if the future, if the probable futures are not what we expect, then it's our duty to find alternatives and to start it, come backward and start it today itself. So I think it's best if we, focusing on climate change, we should promote foresight studies within BIMSTEC regions, because this foresight analysis is, like, you could see it in most of the developed countries, but it's very, there's lack of foresight analysis and future studies in this region. For an example, if you take an example of Singapore, is one of the best, like, one of the countries that pays a, like, has a budget allocation and a specific, like, specialized team on foresight analysis, and they even have a foresight unit in the Prime Minister's office itself. So establishing one of these and focusing on climate-related areas will be best in the current context. And next is local level policies on two specific areas. Number one will be on domestic sewage lines, solid waste dumping, toxic substances, waste, oil and tar. Recently we had this event in Sri Lanka, and then Marine Environment Authority said that, yeah, if you have come to Sri Lanka, you know it's an island nation and there are very beautiful beaches around. And one such example is the Mount Lavinia Beach. But according to Dr. Pradeep, he said that having a swim in Mount Lavinia Beach is like having a swim in a sewage line, because all the houses in the vicinity, they have connected the sewage lines to the this particular beach, and it has like become dumping place of all this dumping pit of all this all of this. And also, since Sri Lanka is mostly focused and mostly interested in all this port-based investment, what I would recommend is, like, for further environmental assessment before the commencement of the investment and the infrastructure projects. I've heard that there are so many, like, when commencing a project in India, there are sustainability studies, but what happens is they just, for the sake of it, they do it and they just give out the report. And then nothing, most of it is ignored when it comes to the policy. So we need to have strict regulation on this. And the second one is local level policies on income generation activities such as tourism and fishery. So this includes observation on indiscriminate allocation of beach lands for construction of hotels and overfishing, damages to coral reef, etc. Because rising ocean temperature and changes in rainfall pattern is very much visible in Sri Lanka these days, and even last month it was visible. And these rising temperatures increase in energy consumption, because cooling temperatures will increase with the amount of cooling will increase with the rising of temperature. So there was some, since I'll be skipping this and I'll go to the next section, that is investment on integrated transportation system. So climate change damages the transportation infrastructure via high temperature, flood, and et cetera. And coastal roads, railways, and ports, all of these become vulnerable to it. And vice versa, transportation and all these emits CO2 and contributes to greenhouse gas emissions. Just taking an example from Bhutan. So they have introduced vehicle emission standards and vehicle running on alternative fuel and electric vehicles with tax incentives. Like I said earlier, we could just look at our like regional countries and then learn from each other. As I said, like in final note, all these issues, even though the root causes are environmental, the outreach goes toward the economic aspect of it, the social aspect of it, the political aspect of it, and if ignored, ultimately towards the national security aspect of it. So what should be done is all these recommendations could be considered, and we need to measure the exact outcome of it and gear up foresight analysis and future studies on environment and climate change and act collaboratively with the BIMSTEC countries. Thank you.
Thank you. So now the last speaker will be Wanapa Lirasiri.
Yes.
Lirasiri. From the Chiang Mai University.
Chiang Mai University. Yes.
So university people speak very specifically, I think, sometimes. Huh? Because you have to teach the younger generation. Huh?
Yes. And so, that's the problem.
Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Shepherdson. I'm very humbled to sit here in the panel today and privileged to be the last one for today. I feel very special because everybody is waiting to get out of this room. So, so I'll be quick. I prepare the effect of climate change, of the global warming, but everybody talk about that, so I decided to talk about myself instead. Actually, I was born in Bangkok. It's the capital city of Thailand. And then after I graduated, I got my PhD, and I got back to my home country. And then I decided to apply for this job in Chiang Mai University, which is located in Chiang Mai province in the north of Thailand. I still remember that was 15 years ago. I'm not that young, even though my face may look very young, though. 15 years ago, my answer to the committee is that I want to have a good way of life, a good quality of life, because Chiang Mai, you know, the mountainous province, very beautiful view, and of course, Chiang Mai has real winter. Bangkok doesn't have. So I stay in Chiang Mai for 15 years, and then I just learned that. For the past 10 years, we faced with this toxic haze problem, PM2.5. Last year, we very proud to have to be the ranked the first in the world for 10 days consecutively. So it means that my life is 10 years shorter than expected because of that PM2.5. Right. Yeah, and of course, that's the problems stem from climate change. And people in the rural area who are in the agricultural sector was blamed for the problem because they have to burn this agricultural waste in order to prepare for the next crops. But people in the city also are one of the problem too, because you know you build all these tall building, it's blocked the wind, so the wind cannot get out, you know, so it become like a dome, a hot dome that keep all this PM2.5 over Chiang Mai city, and now we don't have winter anymore, and the PM2.5 haze strike Chiang Mai during the new year, about January to March. That is the prime time for Chiang Mai tourism. So that affects our economy also. So this is the problem that in everybody's everyday life, without knowing it, it stems from climate change. So for me, climate change is like HIV virus. You don't die because of the HIV, but you die from the problem or disease that caused by, you know, your lower immune. So climate change is pretty much the same thing. And you shouldn't be surprised that we are here, some of us talk about our experience, about our lives. You know, we have the good old day and then we are facing the problem. Because climate change affects every one of us. Even though you're rich or even though you're poor. So wherever you live, you cannot escape the effect of climate change. So all the representatives here speak a very important point about how we can help each other to fight climate change. I have my humble knowledge, I have some suggestion that probably the BIMSTEC countries, members, and all of us can be considered. Probably it may be some way that we can cooperate with each other. Oh, by the way, Bangkok will be underwater in 30 years, just like your city. So the situation in Thailand is not that good. Yeah. Anyhow, at national level, from my understanding, everybody in the BIMSTEC area already have more than one policy targeting climate change one way or another. So I think that's a good idea. And I think it's a very good idea that we share that, you know, from water resource to training. Right? So I think we should keep on doing that and sharing knowledge that we have from our national policy. And the second thing that I learned very much today is about the blue economy. I'm sure that blue is going to be color for next year and the next decade. The blue economy is not just trade, it's not just making profit, but the blue economy also has the environmental side of it too. So the blue economy cannot be sustained. If you adopt blue economy, you have to adopt sustainable development, and you have to think about the climate. That brings me to the regional level. When I was listening to the issue of maritime, and then I think I was sitting there and I think, okay, if the maritime in BIMSTEC country cannot cooperate in terms of security or information, why don't we use issue like environment to bring the maritime of each country together? So in other words, we can mainstream climate change into other area of cooperation of BIMSTEC. You know, start with something small, something that each of us can do in our own capacity, in our own budget and manpower, and then we share that experience and knowledge with each other. And this is something that we can really do. Sharing experts, like our representative from Bhutan here said that you need experts on climate change, right? India have a lot. Sri Lanka has a lot. So we can share that. We can start that by starting a working group, a small working group, BIMSTEC small working group on climate change. And then we work toward a bigger plan for action plan for the region. And the other thing I would like to highlight in my presentation is that we talk very much about technical terms. We talk about how we can use or we can think of something that can help with the melting Himalayas or saving the ocean. But this BIMSTEC area composed of people from different backgrounds. We have a lot of indigenous people. We have a lot of people who have different living lifestyles. We should need to include them into making a plan, a climate change plan. We need to preserve their way of lives, not just preserve the environment. We must help everybody to be able to live the way that they used to live or they choose to live. There should not be climate refugee in this region. We can together help make our area better. I'm very nervous here. I'm sorry. And I think we can upgrade what we have here at the BIMSTEC region. We have, for example, a weather center, BIMSTEC center on weather. So maybe we can extend that BIMTEC weather on center on weather to be a comprehensive information center that link and integrate data from climate change from all member countries. We need a center that can link, you know, real-time data, who can interpret not just, you know, satellite data, but other kind of data that related to the people in the region. And finally, climate change is transboundary environmental problems. No one can fix that alone. BIMSTEC member cannot fix that alone. So we have the global regime for climate change, the Paris Agreement, which all members of the BIMSTEC are party to. And we should utilize that. But we can all together set our own objectives, probably lower than the Paris Agreement, but something that we BIMSTEC countries can do, and agree upon that and work together that kind of objective, you know, step by step. So that's it.
Thank you very much. So I once again thanks our panelist. And before I conclude, I like to open the floor. Director Sahib, please.
Thank you very much. Very useful and presentations. And I think what I liked about the presentations was that it came from the heart. And it links up very well with the point which Vanapaji made, that if you mainstream climate change and weather, etc., into other activities, probably there'll be less opposition. So while there may be some reservations for countries to come together on other issues, but climate change is certainly one area where, and because it links up with a whole lot of other things, where it may be easier to bring that camaraderie, and that too, right from the top, right up to the communities. So we must find some ways of mainstreaming climate change, environment, etc. And I think all the points which have been raised here can easily be included. So that's, I think, a very good point. Now, this is a huge task. There are a number of issues. We have all talked about firstly, lack of expertise, lack of data, lack of awareness, and so many other things. Research and development has also been mentioned. Now, one idea which has been talked about, and I think was briefly kind of touched in some of these presentations, that we already have a whole lot of expertise which is dispersed in the countries across the domains, whether it's wildlife, whether it is fisheries, whether it is glaciers, whether it's lakes, whether it is pollution, and so on and so forth. In India itself, I can count maybe about 50 institutes which might be just working on different aspects. But somehow we have not been able to, and similarly, I'm sure these are there in other countries as well. So if we can somehow bring these institutions, those could be R&D institutions, universities, people working in the community area, in wildlife, in so many other areas, if we can bring them all together, I think, and then address these problems of expertise and training and capacity building and so on and so forth. So one idea which has been talked about, and I think it came up briefly in the last year's presentation also, one idea was what you just mentioned. There is a BIMSTEC weather center here in Noida. That's only weather, but it can be upgraded to discuss climate change. So that we can repeat that suggestion in this year's recommendations also. But more important was that we must build some BIMSTEC institution which links up all these institutions, which means at least make a directory of these institutions, see what is the kind of research that is being done in those institutions, perhaps have a some kind of a search engine where everybody puts all the research there and people can do, you know, start doing research and they can start talking to each other. So this is in today's day and age when you have so much of IT and ICT, etc., that is available, it's not very difficult to make a database of all the research that is going on. Then the same institutions, at least the bigger ones, can then take charge and hold regular conferences and you know, there's information sharing, awareness raising, training and capacity, etc. So we were thinking of a Himalayan Science Council. This was an idea related essentially to the Himalayas at that point of time, but I can see that this can also include maritime and many other issues. So I think it's some kind of an institutional mechanism where all our centers of excellence, universities, all these people who are working in these areas, in different areas, whether it is fisheries, whether it is wildlife, whether it is climate change, weather and so on, they must all come together. And right from technology to social sciences and a community working, etc. So I think this is the suggestion. I don't know what the panel thinks about it and how we can do this. And I don't know, BIMSTEC Secretariat, people are here or no now? Yeah, so if you remember last time also we had discussed this Himalayan Science Council kind of an idea. But this same idea is coming back to us again and again in different forms. So with the help of, perhaps this idea should be taken to the summit level. And let the summit people, they look at it, and many other ideas which will actually emerge from here. But I think this is very important to address these soft issues. It's easier to build consensus on softer issues than on the harder issues. I think this is also the point which is coming up. But we must have some kind of an institutional framework. And as was pointed out, that we could have our own objectives for, or you know, some kind of aims and objectives on climate change within the BIMSTEC, even small ones. Like for instance, every country chooses 100 schools where some kind of an awareness is raised. So that that becomes a kind of a BIMSTEC activity. So I don't know what the panel thinks about it, but I'll be very interested in having your views. Yeah, thank you.
There, somebody.
Just to bank on what Dr. Gupta has said, two quick points. One is, I think we now have quite a lot of center of excellence. Even if you go to Dhaka, we have recently set up a maritime university, which is dedicated for looking into Bay of Bengal, and which has the capacity to work on the climate change. Perhaps BIMSTEC can actually tag along and start pilot programs. And even they can do it with Thammasat University, which has a maritime department, I presume. So at least rather than immediately setting up a new institution, let us work on with the one that is existing right away. So I think this is how you immediately proceed on something which can be considered as a low-hanging fruit. Now, one concern that is coming up, and most of the time we're actually not looking into it very seriously, is the cost of insurance is rising whenever you are embarking on the hydroelectricity projects or the energy-related projects in the mountain areas. Now, recently when Bangladesh was talking about investing in Bhutan, when the discussion was going on with the International Finance Corporation, one issue came up is the insurance cost. The insurance cost is now astronomically high, because they are now putting the climate change risk and everything into that, for which the risk factor goes up. Now, these are the issues, which means your climate financing pattern and trend is also changing. So henceforth, the BIMSTEC countries can perhaps look into these financial arrangements, and these are the low-hanging fruits which can be looked into. And the last one is, I think there are a lot of initiatives going on in the BIMSTEC countries, particularly in the urbanization areas. Now, UNDP is supporting, then ADB is supporting a number of initiatives building smart cities and so and so. And perhaps if you look in look at Dhaka, if you look at Delhi, if you look at Mumbai, if you look at, as you have rightly mentioned, in Bangkok, or perhaps the new city being grown in Colombo, all these cities are now looking forward to new revisions in the urbanization process. And perhaps these are the areas where within the climate format, every city will be very happy to come together and start talking about the climate change and how the cities can participate. And I think there is also a greater synergy among the mayors of all these cities now coming forward to really participate in dialogues with the other cities and share their knowledge. At least I know that Dhaka's two mayors are now looking forward to see how Delhi is changing, how Mumbai is changing, and how perhaps Colombo is changing, and what you have said within 30 years, if Colombo in Bangkok is going down the water, half of our city will be very unhappy, shopping will be going away. So certainly for their own interest, they will be hopping into Bangkok mayor and see that how we can deal with it. So therefore, I think this can be a proposal that we can really, very small initiative, but a good initiative, that the mayors and the city planners can always come together under the BIMSTEC working groups. And so these are immediate things that we can always do.
I think there was one somebody there on the back. No, here. Please.
Thank you, Chair. I'll just say a couple of points on the subject of climate change. In fact, there was a proposal to have an intergovernmental expert group who is supposed to develop an action plan as per the decision of the Fourth Summit.
Yes.
And the climate change, the lead country for BIMSTEC is Bangladesh. So we hope this meeting will be convened very soon. And on the issue of blue economy, we have circulated a concept paper from the Secretariat, how we should have intergovernmental expert group on blue economy. And what Bangladesh government says, they will be holding this first meeting in the first, maybe in the month of March next year. So they have agreed to host the meeting. And on the issue of Himalayan Science Council, in fact, the first meeting of the experts is scheduled on 5th and 6th of December, next week only, in Goa. So hopefully the meeting takes place. In fact, we have got the nomination from all the member countries. So if that happens, probably we'll be discussing all the subjects concerning Himalayan issues in that first expert group meeting. So they will also explore whether we need to have a Himalayan Science Council as a permanent kind of body. So hopefully in the expert group meeting, either if it's held in December or maybe in the month of January, we'll definitely discuss all these issues together. Thank you.
You see, somehow or the other, the people think that climate change has to be tackled by the government, the pollution has to be tackled by the government. I think it is required now that we tell the people that they have themselves to talk about this. I'll give you a small example. Delhi's pollution, for example. This year, there is an uproar, actually, starting from the judiciary to the people down below. And everybody has been forced to think about it. So what I'm trying to put across is that it affects the people. It is not the governments which are being affected, because then the buck is passed on. So what I would like to say is the stories you related, there is a definite requirement for BIMSTEC think tank to be able to popularize these aspects, how they affect you. And I met a lady the other day, and I said, your child is not coming. They used to come. I mean, me and my wife work. She says, don't you know this is the pollution? So what I'm trying to tell you is when the people start talking about it, when the people start talking about the beaches, when people start talking about Jamuna, for example, Jamuna is a beautiful river. It is not at the moment. I remember, it's a good thing to be old because you remember something which was very good when you were young. I have swum in Jamuna. We have gone for picnics to Jamuna. And look what we have done to it. So the point is, this is somehow the price which you have to pay when there is industrialization and when there is development. But this can be halted. When you all of you have tales about this area, why don't we popularize them? Why don't we make it a people's movement across the board in the BIMSTEC countries? You see, this is one area where you'll have nobody objecting to it. Nobody's nationalist feelings will be hurt because everyone is getting affected. I would say that talk about it more, publish more about it, and tell people that you are affected. For example, there'll be no fish. I'm not a fish eating person. I'm from Haryana. By the way, gender sort of this thing is not so bad at the moment. But what is but I'm just trying to say across, to put across is, when the people come to say, realize that the best type of fish is no more available. No, the Bengali fish, which is liked by Bengalis on the both sides of the border, is disappearing. So you see, when you start finding that the best of the things you used to are going away, when you find the hill stations, which I remember are hill station, pristine hill stations, that somehow instead of trees you find the 10-story buildings. So this is something, it's a heritage which is being lost across the board. So I would very strongly recommend that try and make it into a people's moment. Try and make it into a loss which is a collective loss across the board. And I think that is how you'll induce the politics to come into the whole thing, because the politicians always will do something with the apologies, ma'am, to you, because if your constituents come to you and tell you that the environment is the priority one, then I think the rules and laws will be passed. So I would very strongly urge that make climate a people's, what do you call, subject, people's moment. Thank you.
So I think now I'll request the panelist. So if you have anything to...
Thank you very much. I fully agree with the director. And then the view that pointed out by our participants. The one thing that the beauty that my country is taking forward is that in our system, we are trying to mainstreaming the environment, climate change into every development process. So in that context, when we do our practical at the end of the day, it's really an expansive thing at the end. So, but it's as a government policy, we have to mainstream every activity that we take. So another thing that our government is looking is with the regard to the climate sensitive projects, let's say for example hydropower projects, we are also exploring the other means to how to overcome this single-driven economy towards other renewable energy from the wind and so on all. Plus, we are also trying to explore the possibility from generation of energy through the waste, waste to the energy. So this is something that I think we need to work in close collaboration with the BIMSTEC countries, I think.
That's it.
I just want to say one thing. The Indian government is spending huge amount of money in cleaning our national river. I am not sure whether this effort will manage to clean Ganga or not, but unless we change the mindset of people, we cannot clean our rivers. And mindset can be changed when we intervene at the school level. So the suggestion was rightly given. I mean, we have to build it in the curriculum. I remember when I was a school kid studying in a very rural school in Orissa, we had a SUPW class, social, useful class. So go and clean the surroundings, not only school, the surrounding area of the school. I think that is stopped. We have to get back to those things, very basic things we have to do, then only we can clean up things. And thank you for giving this opportunity.
Thank you. I was just discussing with, about we are having the railways till Cox's Bazar from Chittagong. And there are many areas where wild elephants pass through. So the challenge is, what do? We make overpasses for the wild elephants to move through. How will you make them take the overpasses? Or we make bridges, flyovers for the trains to go through. challenges to make balance between connectivity, economic development, GDP, to make everything sustainable. So we are all facing this problem. And the challenge is there that we have to overcome and we have to work together. It's when we share the best practices and when we not just talk about it, we have to ensure implementation. If we talk about an idea and then take it to the summit level, then it is talked about again, then it is decided on, then implementation is not even in 3 years. In these 3 years, so many things are happening. Our environment is getting more damaged. And we must also talk about the air quality, like Dr. Wanafa was speaking, and Delhi had very bad air quality. Now it's Dhaka. Dhaka is the worst. And there is no Dhaka, it's not happening because of burning residue of the crops. It's for all the brick kilns around Dhaka. And bricks are required to make buildings. We are moving into the environment-friendly bricks. It's taking time. All our economies are energy hungry. We need energy. We need to focus more on cross-border trade of clean energy. Thank you so much.
Lakshmanji, you want to say anything? Please.
This annual emission gap report says, even though that all the countries have made arrangements and they are working forward to fulfill their promises of this 1.5 Celsius promise, it says that even if all promises, even if all the countries work towards this, that promise cannot be met, and it'll the world will warm more than more than double that amount by 2100. So like she said, we could it's one of the best recommendations to go towards smaller targets and achieve it in region wise and begin it with school, with the curriculum, like I said, and then pay more attention to development with sustainable development and smart city management, once again with sustainable development, and always look at the sustainable aspect of everything.
Let's find something substantial that we can do, and let's do it today.
So now there is a saying in Nepali, "Sunne lai sunko mala." It means those who have listened, they have the gold garland. And those "Bhanne lai phulko mala," those who have spoken, who have the flower garland. So we say thank you very much because you are with good listeners during the evening also. And thanks to our panelists also. Now I'll take 2 minutes just. One thing is that we have a task, can the BIMSTEC countries formulate a roadmap to address the challenges of climate change in the region? I think this session has slightly give some remarks on how to make the roadways, further roadways to combat the negative impact of the climate change. And I'm thinking that we're talking about the regional securities. Now climate, the consequences of the climate change will be on the water. So water security is going to be one of the biggest issues. Water is related to the agriculture, then food security is the another issue. So all these have a region, and these new types of securities. We'll be talking tomorrow about the cyber security and others, but there are the climate change securities. For that, I just say what we should go more ahead, that most of the countries, we have the climate change policies. We have the environmental laws, acts, regulations in most of the countries, but these things are not being enforced strictly, I'll say. As you mentioned, that the people's movement, if it will be made, then might be because our parliamentarians or our politicians, they still, you know, has not taken up these things, you see. So let us work more on the policy, laws, rules, regulations, and the peaceful movement. Nonetheless, whatever you have the commitments, these things cannot be tackled without the scientific data, technical knowledge, and new way of innovations. So the science, technology, and innovation in the climate change is the very, very important section. And the BIMSTEC, what they are talking about, the Himalayan Science Council. I think that has a big task to the to be formed as immediately as Director Gupta has said. So there's a lot of institutions working, but there is no, you see, interlinked or sharing of the knowledge. So that should be also in the field of science, technology, and innovation, the climate change, the data, the sharing of the knowledge, and the partnership will be required to for the road. Regarding the Bhutan and other countries, there is a big financial crunch. And you see, there is a, if we jointly approach even to the others agencies, they are saying Green Climate Fund, there is others global international funds also. So in the Nepal government, every government should contribute, as our Lakshmanji has said, the contributions should be the participatory and the, so many things. So financial things is another the big issue. Lastly, I think when I go meet the peoples, we say these are the problems, but who is going to solve these problems? There is no sufficient human resources tackling, whether you are going to tackle these all environmental issues, pollution issues, all these new technology, all these things. So I think if you want to wrote the, made the roadmaps, the human resources you can do, has it been targeted, what would be the adaptations technology requires, what are the mitigations method to be done, what are the technology and other things. So I think there is a lot of challenges. But lastly, what I see, what you say when you say that as now the COP sits every year, why not there should be a idea of COP BIMSTEC, so that the every year, not only the summit, but a conference of the parties on the climate change of the BIMSTEC. If we can initiate, if this conference, this dialogue gives push forward to bringing a conference of the parties of the BIMSTEC, then every year we can meet and discuss all these agenda together. With these few remarks, I thank you again for giving us the opportunity to the Vivekanand International Foundations and to all the participants and to all our panelists. Thank you very much that you are very humble and very kindful. And I as I talking before, you see, in this we have all gentle ladies, you see, with the big participation. So give big hands to our ladies also, because they are very much affected by all these things. You see, we all the time now talk in our every issue that we have to make it more inclusive, especially in this region where, where there is the less participation of the women in this sector. So thank you very much. With this, I think we have any announcement?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Before we close day one, I have a couple of announcements. There is an invitation for a dinner in all your bags. So we look forward to seeing you join us at Hotel La Meridian later this evening. Tomorrow's day two and session four will start at 10 o'clock. So if you could please take note of that. And lastly, may I request all the women delegates and the panelists to join us on the stage for a photo.
No. Special photo.
Yes, they know that. A vehicle would be coming to take you back to your hotel and then directly to the dinner. Okay, 7 o'clock. So
you want to let
the photos are in front of Swamiji's statue or here. Here. He's taken. Sir, could I request you to stay back so that.
A photo bhejna bhaiya.